Please welcome Managing Director of Detroit Program for the Kresge Foundation, Wendy Lewis Jackson.
Good morning, everyone. I'm coming apart at the seams here, just a sec. So, welcome, and I hope you enjoyed our debut of our centennial video. You might have noticed we're having a birthday at the Kresge Foundation. We're turning 100. And so this session is extremely fitting for how we're thinking about, you know, our current work, but also the work of where we're headed in the future as a foundation, and particularly our work in Detroit. And so I'm really excited to have you all join us for this conversation. It should be lively, it should be provocative on the power of place. We've had many conversations here at Mackinac about investment in our places, in our cities, but this session today is really about how investments in place and putting together the kind of civic infrastructure, financial infrastructure, and educational infrastructure that is going to be needed, and having the courage to do so as a state in order to retain and grow our population. So I hope that you will be encouraged by what you hear from our amazing panelists, but also it's going to be a call to action this morning. And how do we take the conversation that we're having and really apply it to our policy work, our investment work as philanthropy, the work of the business community, and other civic leaders. So let me get right to it and introduce our incredible panel and have them come up while we're doing this. So first, please welcome Stephen Henderson, who will be serving as our moderator today. And then we're extremely honored and thrilled to have Valerie Jarrett join us. Valerie is the CEO of the Obama Foundation and has also served as senior advisor to President Obama and the White House. So Valerie, welcome. Anika Goss, who is the CEO of Detroit Future City, will come to the stage. And Anika and I, we did not plan this color coordination, and I will not be doing a step show this morning. Anika might be able to do it. And then please welcome Andre Perry with the Brookings Institution as well. So thanks again, and Stephen, I'll turn it over to you while I make my way to my seat.
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I know it's complicated.
Okay. That's right.
So I want to, of course, welcome our panelists. But before we get started, I want to say something quickly about the idea of place and its importance. I think it's impossible to talk about place or to think about place, especially in a city like Detroit, without thinking about the people who inhabit that place, who make up that place, and who depend on the kind of civic infrastructure we're talking about to make their lives successful. So hopefully we will be able to talk an awful lot about people as well as place. But I want to start with this phrase, civic infrastructure. It's a great phrase in a lot of ways, and you know, for nerds like me who sit around thinking about policy all the time, it's a very handy phrase. But I want to give a more, I think, specific kind of explanation and understanding of what we're talking about when we say something like civic infrastructure. So I want to start there with you, Valerie. When you think of that phrase, what comes to mind?
Well, first of all, good morning, everyone. This is my first trip to Mackinac, and I couldn't be happier, and I'm kind of trying to figure out why it took me so long to get here. But anyway, I'm delighted to be with you all here. And you mentioned that phrase to me as we were in the back of the room, and I had never heard of it before. But the first thing that came to my mind was a story about Detroit. And so when Detroit really hit the bottom of its financial challenges, we had a meeting in the White House. And the people who showed up represented the civic infrastructure of the city. So we had the entire delegation that represented Detroit from members of Congress. We had people from the philanthropic community, so Rip was there. We had Dan Gilbert. We had members who were just kind of grassroots leaders, all who were completely committed to rejuvenating Detroit. And the governor had me on speed dial. He called all the time. And I remember when I left that meeting, I thought, they have the infrastructure that it takes to come up with a comprehensive plan for how to rebuild Detroit. And if you look at Detroit today, it has come back. And it's the people that make up the civic infrastructure and who are willing to get on a plane and fly to Washington to make a personal commitment to the President of the United States that they were not going to let Detroit fail. So that's one definition close to home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Anika?
You know, I think the way I would want to think about civic infrastructure is in more in the context of why we choose to live in a specific place. And in Detroit, the equity gaps still exist, particularly in the effort to create a middle class lifestyle for you and your family. And you're having to make choices to live someplace that's more affordable, where the schools are better, that's closer to a higher paying job. And you're having to make these decisions to live in places where you don't have your own, where you're not building a civic infrastructure. You're making choices because these are the things that you feel like are the essentials, the amenities that you can't live without in order to either raise a family or have the kind of quality of life. And I want to remind us that in Detroit, 26% of households are middle class as opposed to 39% of households in the region. And if you look at all of the region in its entirety makes up 692 census tracts, and 51% of those are considered middle class places, meaning that more than 50% of the area of the household income is making more than $50,000 or $52,000 a year. And only 15 out of 692 census tracts are in Detroit. So, but, you know, our population just grew, right? We're all excited about that. We're that's worth a pause. How's that been in 6 years? But I feel like there's a challenge for us, and then I'm gonna stop talking and move on.
That's okay.
There's a challenge for us in that, because while the population has lost, we've continued to decline in black population. We've continued to decline, losing black households to the suburbs, middle class black households. And for the first time ever, we're losing Latino households. We saw a drop in the Latino population, according to the ACS estimate. And so the only population that's growing, thank you, white people, for moving to Detroit. However, they're only moving to the neighborhoods where that are stable and where there is the highest level investment, where there is civic infrastructure. So I feel like we have if we're going to take on the civic infrastructure framework, we have a lot of work to do in order to build that civic infrastructure in Detroit and in the region.
I love having Anika on panels because she says all the things that I would say, and then I don't have to say them.
Okay, sorry.
Andre.
Yeah, first of all, thanks for having me. It's great to be in a packed room. But civic infrastructure is one of those terms that either a philanthropic organization or a think tank made up. And sometimes, you know, right, it's probably from the Brookings Institution. I mean, seriously,
I was gonna
say. Talk about it in the hallways all the time. But but it is really represents the civic organizations that organize the way we live. They have the capacity to bring in the resources and distribute resources in ways that sustains or grows the community. So when you think of that civic infrastructure, think about the chambers of commerce, think about the city council, think about the library system, the school system. But and we generally think about those things. But also think about those institutions that if you ask a resident, why do you stay here? Mm-hmm. It's good getting to, and then you're including those daycare centers. Mm-hmm. Then you're including the gypsy cab service you may have. There are organizations in all of our communities that make them work and grow and sustain themselves. Now, why this is tricky is because there's power dynamics in civic infrastructure that can limit and restrict resources so that some areas of the city can grow or not. And in addition, there are some places that simply do not have the civic infrastructure needed. You see seen this during the pandemic, where we're trying, and like when PPP loans were distributed, were there financial institutions in proximity to the people who need it? Not in all places. So this think about the word civic organizations, infrastructure, meaning sort of the brick and mortar, sort of the plumbing necessary for those things to operate. And what you have are the organizations that organize our lives. Mm.
Yeah. Wendy?
You know, I come at it from, like we've all been talking about, from the idea of people in place and what is needed to bridge those two things together. But even at a deeper level, I think about civic infrastructure through the eyes of a child. Mm. And what it means to be able to grow up, particularly in a neighborhood within our cities, and what are the things that are absolutely critical that we invest in order to provide that good plumbing, that connectivity. So it's more than just bricks and mortar. It is how we think about investments in education, how we think about investments in public space, housing, all of those sectors that really need to come together, not only bridge, but also braid in a way that provides greater opportunity for young people and families. And so if we come at it again through the eyes of a child and think about how are we truly investing, how are we truly lifting up policies that support what is needed in our communities to make them stronger and continue to focus on population growth, I think that our policy conversations will need to change pretty significantly.
Yeah. So I want to drill down on Detroit for just a minute and talk about our civic infrastructure, how we're doing with that, and where the gaps are. And so I'm going to come back to you first, Anika, to talk about the things that you see working, not working, and the opportunities to move more in the right direction.
Yeah. So I think, you know, one of the things that I feel like has a lot of promise, and I want to tee you up for this, Dr. Andre, is the Strategic Neighborhood Fund. And the reason that I want to focus on that is I believe the Livernois 6 Mile area is probably, and if those of you who are not familiar, this is an area that has historically been majority Black. And in the 50s, 60s, and up until the 70s, was a thriving business district that was bordered by two universities and a private school. It's five neighborhoods that range from multi-million dollar mansions. I'm assuming they were multi-million dollar at one time. I don't know if they are now, but very large homes to very modest homes. This is all one neighborhood, right? Maybe three, is it three census tracts? Maybe a little more.
More.
But anyway, this name, over time, there's been $260 million of investment in this area. And the Andre and his team, the Brookings Institution, focused on whether or not the neighborhood was able to gentrify. And were they losing the demography there? I believe they didn't, and I think you all proved that it didn't. And I think what's so important about that civic infrastructure point mm-hmm. is that in other neighborhoods where we have seen, that are SNF, those early SNF neighborhoods, where we didn't take the time to make sure there were Black-owned businesses, where we didn't take the time to make sure that the housing was intact and reflected the neighborhood that existed, and that the schools were also connected to that investment, because we were making this kind of investment for the first time, you didn't see that. These neighborhoods are beginning to gentrify. The demographic looks different, the income is different, the neighborhood feels different. And I feel like that one single initiative could be replicated, especially there's an opportunity now that they're going to do it again to advance that same model.
I want to give Dr. Perry a chance to talk about his research in that area, but it seems to me that one of the things you're saying, Anika, is that civic infrastructure is kind of a start, but you have to go beyond that in
Absolutely.
Order to make sure that people aren't moved out and that people are included.
Well, so we did an analysis where we looked at, measured the population over the last 20 years in the Livermore 6 Mile area of Detroit. And we looked at the level of investment over that time. And we saw a large level of investment, particularly over the last, since 2015 or so. And typically that foreshadows some displacement. But what we saw in terms of home prices are relatively going up in a modest pace. Education is going up at a modest pace. The Black population is pretty stable. There's only been a small uptick in the white community in the university district for the most part. And what that tells me is that you do have healthy infrastructure and appropriate investments in it. I think the difference between that area of Detroit and others, and we can talk about Chicago, we can talk about lots of places, because lots of cities are dealing with this problem. We need development. I just want to be clear about this. We need investments in communities. Most of you know me through my work on housing devaluation, and we know that policies and practices have robbed Black communities in particular of the resources that they use on their own to thrive. So we need that equity in our communities, and we need development. With that said, if you're not going to invest in the people who are the civic infrastructure in the place, you eventually will get that gentrification. And what I saw during that period is direct investments in the developers who actually live in the community, mm-hmm. the business owners who actually live in the community. When you see that level of investment, now, mind you, the story's not completely written. We're not seeing displacement right now. But what it tells me, if we continue to have a very clear focus on giving the communities what they need in terms of the land, the landscaping, the streetscapes, the parking, investing in new facades, investing in new property owners. But by the way, Black people represent about 14% of the population, but only 2% of employer firms. And so we need to scale that up. One of the ways to scale that up is to make sure that there's new ownership of commercial property. 80% of all commercial property is owned by the top 1% of all of families. And so when I can go to any block and one or two people own most all of the commercial real estate. We've got to get more diversity in that mix. So for me, what I saw in this one community is a foundation contributing, But more importantly, banks lending loans for businesses, for home ownership. That's the real infrastructure. We're not, I say this all the time, we're not going to nonprofit our way out of these problems, right? Like, you can clap that up, right? I mean, I love Kresge. Kresge supported.
I was going to say, I don't know.
That wonderful.
I don't know.
But with that
know
said.
Know your audience on it.
Support. But with that said, we need banks to work for the people in their communities. We need home ownership to work in the community. That's your civic engine. When those things happen, you know you have a healthy infrastructure.
Yeah. Yeah. Wendy, philanthropy has played such an important part in changing place and civic infrastructure in Detroit. What's your reaction to the things that Andre and others have said?
Yeah. No, I think that, you know, philanthropy has to be a part of the equation. If we've proved anything in the city, it's, you know, that for sure. But it's being a part of the equation to come at these issues with intention and making sure that we're setting tables that change the conditions for the kinds of changes that we're starting to see in that particular part of the city, but also other parts of the city. And that's been a, you know, increasingly the story of philanthropy in cities across this country, that role of like bringing the civic leaders to the table. And when I say leaders, I'm actually talking about residents that live in these communities and know what they need, you know, what they want to see happen in terms of investment and housing and schools, and making sure that their voice is front and center in the process of change, and making sure that they are an equal part of all the other actors that are coming together to make sure that we have the kind of infrastructure that we need in these communities. So yes, philanthropy is an important part, and the role that we play is a little different, but you do have to have, at the end of the day, private sector investment and public sector investment. And it has to be coordinated, and it has to be brought to the table in a way that I think leverages other resources, particularly philanthropic resources. Yeah. And we've been underinvesting as a state in our cities and in our places.
Yeah, Valerie, in some ways, I think about the Obama years as a return, I guess, or a refocus on the power of government to build things like civic infrastructure, to invest in some of these things after a pretty long period of the opposite. And then, of course, in the years since, we've seen a real retreat from that. You're now in the philanthropic sector. I wonder if you can give us a sense of what you feel was accomplished by the Obama administration in this space, and then what we've lost, I guess, since then.
Well, let me go back a little further, if you'll indulge me. Yeah. 30 years ago, I was a commissioner of planning and development for the city of Chicago. And I had grown up in a community in Chicago, Hyde Park, Kenwood, that had a very strong civic infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Big employer, University of Chicago and the Medical Center, vibrant community organizations, engaged citizenry, strong local elected officials. I mean, the ingredients that you, open space, good schools, a community that people would choose to live in if they had alternatives. This would be a neighborhood of choice. Immediately adjacent to a neighborhood that was predominantly low income, black, lots of vacant land from buildings that had been demolished, boarded up buildings, high crime rate, poor schools. And I started to think, well, what do we do to rebuild that infrastructure? And one of my observations, other than that I would never, ever work for the federal government because I didn't think they understood how to rebuild communities, so never say that. But our approach wasn't from a programmatic approach. It was listening first to to the people who live in the community. Mm-hmm. And the MacArthur Foundation gave us a grant to do a community planning exercise. Mm-hmm. And it was excruciatingly painful because what I realized after the first meeting is that the community didn't agree on their vision for the community. But they kept showing up, and this very strong community-based organization brought people together, and they had charrettes and they had designs. And when it was finished, what they wanted was just what every community wanted. They wanted affordable housing. They wanted to attract new housing so that there was market rate opportunities for people upwardly mobile. They wanted jobs, open space for their kids to play, grocery stores where they didn't have to worry about food deserts. And we took this incredible asset of vacant land and made it available for a dollar to bring down the cost so we could have more affordable housing. And then that allowed us to take the market rate housing where they paid for the land at market value and use it to subsidize. And so the city was there to help fulfill the dreams of the people on mm-hmm. the ground. And if I were to drive around Chicago today, I would say the cities that have had long-term sustainable progress are the ones where you had community-based organizations mm-hmm. and strong local elected leaders who were forcing the government to pay attention to their needs and figure out how to take this myriad of programs and tailor them and to not look at it in kind of the narrow silos that oftentimes government does, mm-hmm. but look at it from the view of the person who wants to live there and raise their children there. And when you do it that way and you have a place-based strategy that is holistic, you're looking at not just the capital needs of the community, but what are the human needs mm-hmm. of the community? What do the schools look like? What are the opportunities for children to thrive and grow and be safe as they are playing in their communities? And when I drive around, the ones that have those ingredients mm-hmm. are the ones that have vastly improved today. Now, is there blowback? Do they gentrify in some cases? Does the government not quite calibrate correctly? Inevitably, that's the case. But if you ask the people who live there, are you better off today than you were back then, 30 years ago, they would say yes. Now, it took a long time, and that's the other thing I think that sometimes we don't realize that these mm-hmm. kind of changes don't happen overnight, mm-hmm. because if they do, then people feel completely shaken up. There's nothing more important to you than the place where you live. Mm-hmm. And so when you ask about the Obama administration, we tried to take the lessons that President Obama learned as a community organizer and as a state senator, and then working in the U.S. Senate from the federal perspective, and shake up the federal government so it would be a partner to help fulfill and leverage. And I look at government as like priming the pump. They are in there with the initial dollars to help get things jump-started that the private sector has chosen not to do, and then to create the kind of certainty that it's going to go, that it's going to get this level of funding so that you can bring in and leverage those private dollars so the banks are willing to lend in the community. And then government should get out of the way and let the people fulfill their dreams. Mm. And that was the approach that we tried to bring to the federal government. But we believe that our cities are the economic engine of our country, mm. and that we have to invest in them. And that is not charity, that is an investment where you are gonna get a return on that investment. And I think some of that passion for cities evaporated when President Obama left office. And we're trying to get that back again. But it does, I guess the point I really want to emphasize is the lesson I learned on the ground is do listen to the people that you are there to help, mm-hmm. and don't come in with your preconceived notions of what's good for them. They actually know what they want.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, can I?
Go ahead.
Just to illustrate something, I'm always reminded, I mean, everything starts local, good and bad. From a bad illustration, redlining, for instance, started in Baltimore. Mayor Barry Mehul wanted to isolate the black community. And so, because people have this misconception that redlining kind of started at the federal level. No, it was codified and resourced mm-hmm. by the federal government, and it worked its way up. Now, I always, when you look at the impact of redlining for generations, I use that as a lesson. And this is where philanthropy has a role. We need to demonstrate, instead of policies and practices that are exclusionary, ones that are inclusive in nature. And then we need government to codify and resource them. Mm-hmm. There are still ideas at the local level that can be as impactful in a positive way as redlining. They are in Detroit, they're in Chicago, they're in Wilkinsburg, Pennsylvania, where I was raised. There are answers. But we need to resource them and eventually get them codified and then resource at the federal level. Because right now, they're in the two critical areas of wealth creation, for the most part, I mean, the largest is the stock market, but we can talk about that and those disparities in wealth gaps as a result of stock market disparity. But if you're not talking about housing and business development, then you're not talking about growing our communities. Right now, there's no housing policy at the federal level. Right? And even when we're talking about development, it's really for rental property development. We need to figure out a way to create a new generation of owners. And we need to build properties, and we don't have those resources. Mm-hmm. And so for me, a forward-looking vision is to figure out ways, hey, how can we get these special purpose credit programs that don't require a down payment in communities, targeted in the neighborhoods, that we see some promise? How can we get more commercial corridors refurbished and get new owners? How can we scale up these founders? And by the way, I think there's a lot of good discussion of starting a business. We need much bigger discussion about acquiring and scaling our firms. We need that kind of focus. So, and that's a role for philanthropy. We can demonstrate what can happen, but we absolutely need government at the federal level, state level. We're here in Mackinac Policy Government, state government. And our big corporations to resource these ideas so that they can scale.
I want to go back to the growth question. Nika, you brought up the fact that Detroit is growing again for the first time since 1957, which is longer than I have been alive and longer than many of us have been alive, and that it is good news. But again, when you dig down beneath that number and look at what's actually happening. I had a conversation with the mayor this morning who talked about the number of black families who moved out of Detroit in the decade before this. Is growth the key to some of what we're talking about here? Is it necessary? And what kind of growth are we looking for? You talked about the growth from new, younger, whiter, wealthier residents. How do we grow different populations? How do we attract people back to the city who've left because they feel like there's nothing here for them?
Yeah, and not only nothing for them, I mean, one of the things that we've been internally talking about at Detroit Future City is when a neighborhood becomes untenable to live in, meaning there is so much blight, there is so much disinvestment, there is either real or perception of crime, and there are no schools, those neighborhoods will gentrify by just because they look so bad, right? It's probably one of the few areas in the country where, because it's not, we haven't studied it in the community development sector the same way, but it is a form of gentrification. And really thinking about what does it require to change a neighborhood to make it more attractive for a multitude of different kinds of households, you have to think about, this is where place really comes in. Mm-hmm. It doesn't, you know, I think oftentimes, especially in major cities, our standard of excellence ends up being that white middle class suburb. I haven't made it until I have a garage in the front of my house and a yard. And in fact, there might be a lot of different ways to create thriving, resilient, beautiful neighborhoods. Maybe they're dense, maybe they're low dense and have large scale green. Maybe they have some sort of green stormwater infrastructure. Maybe they have a number of trees. There's an orchard in the middle of the neighborhood. There are a number of ways that you can create a neighborhood that feels like it is connected, that offers different kinds of amenities to attract a variety. First of all, before you even get into growth, we got to get people to stay. Mm-hmm. And so in order to do that, you have to have those kinds of neighborhoods that would allow people to stay. One of the things that I think, one of the reasons I think this is so important is because I think we often think about a Detroit versus region, mostly because I talk about it that way, and I talk a lot, that we think Detroit versus the rest of the region. But economies are regional, right? Economic development is regional. And so we should be thinking about our communities in Detroit and the people who live there as everyone that is a Detroiter right now and could be a Detroiter. It should be fairly and fully participating in the regional economy. And if they are not, then we are failing as a region. And I feel like that should be the goal. You should live here. There should be every opportunity to live here as there is everywhere else. And I feel like we don't make that shift.
Yeah. Wendy, Kresge has done a number of really interesting things in the city to try to foster growth, to try to create the conditions for growth. I'm thinking here in particular about the investment at Mary Grove and the neighborhood around that. How long do we anticipate that takes to actually work in the way that we want it to? And not that it hasn't been successful, but I mean, it does seem like we're still so far from what we all might imagine is possible.
Well, I think the timescale question is really important, and to come at it in increments. And you know what Valerie said around the work in Chicago with the MacArthur Foundation and the community plans, which is work that we looked at mm-hmm. at the Kresge Foundation when I first arrived. And it, you know, we're talking about, you know, 10, 20 years.
Decades.
Mm-hmm. And we have to be honest about that. Change is not going to happen overnight, but we can have toll gates and benchmarks that, you know, for residents in particular, can see progress. And at times you need to, and this is where philanthropy is really important, because in many ways we can make those like big catalytic investments in neighborhoods that start to signal for residents and community that, you know, certain changes are underway. So with our Mary Grove project, for example, you know, that's a really good one, because that was kind of our way to begin to signal with a number of different partners that we can bring a new educational model to a neighborhood that has implications for the entire city in the way that we think about neighborhood schools. But we're only, I don't know, my clock started a lot earlier with that project, so I don't know, probably only 5 years in, but when we first started talking about it at the foundation, it was probably a decade ago. So, you know, examples like that, but I, you
know, it's not just Marigold. I mean, there's right. a lot going on in the neighborhood around it that Kresge is mm-hmm. supporting as well.
Yeah, and I think that's at least how we've been thinking so much about our work at Kresge in Detroit and the other cities where we work across the country is, you know, how do you pull these threads together mm-hmm. To make change in place? And whether it's the educational system and how it connects to the open space system, how do we think about economic development, small business development? It has to be, to Valerie's point, holistic. You can't come at one without the other. And To Anika's point, and I don't know, it may be a little different from how you're thinking about it, mm-hmm. but we've always come at our work in Detroit and probably the other communities where we work as well, that yes, we're part of a region, but Detroit has to be the number one job center in that
mm-hmm.
region.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just a little different frame.
Yeah.
You know what? You can clap.
Go ahead.
But you know, I love this quote, and I use it like it keeps my teeth white. But Tic Tac Non said that if you're growing a head of lettuce, and the lettuce isn't growing, you don't blame the lettuce. You look to see if the soil's enriched. You look to see if it's getting sunlight. You look to see if it's getting water. The reason why I say that Kresge, the state, can have an initiative, say we're going, or Detroit Future City can have an initiative, we're going to grow this neighborhood. And then it becomes, is it working? Is it working? You know, we've got to focus on the conditions. When we, in particular, when it comes to Black communities, when things aren't growing, we blame Black people,
mm.
right? But we also will blame this governor or this foundation. You can't blame the lettuce. You have to look at the rainwater, the soil, the sunlight, the housing, the workforce development, the schools. Focus on those things.
Mm-hmm.
You will get growth, right? You will get growth. But what you cannot do, in particular, and it's very, it's always in fashion during political season to point fingers, to say, you didn't do this or you didn't do that. Conferences like this must be focused on a policy agenda that extends beyond a political season.
Right.
Have to. About creating the conditions for growth, period.
Yeah. Valerie, this gets to how hard this is to do, and part of it is about that alignment, right? The alignment of more than just philanthropy, the alignment of more than just government, the alignment of more than just business. It gets to what Andre's saying about reshaping the conditions that create the spaces we all live in.
And recognizing that does not happen overnight, and I couldn't agree with you more. One of the ways in which foundations can be helpful is coming in a sense your neutral player mm-hmm. and bring people to the table who are the stakeholders and who have the resources that you want to attract to a place. And I think that, and recognize that the horizon can't be measuring success over a 6-month or a 1-year interval. Yeah. And so be clear up front about what the expectations are and what is necessary, to your point, mm-hmm. to get that soil going in the right direction. And I think that everybody has an appropriate role to play in this. And one thing that I've been sitting here thinking that we haven't talked about that concerns me about the future, and look, I spend my day with young people who are part of the Obama Foundation Leadership Program, and these mm-hmm. are superstars and they are going to change the world. But the world is a very different place today than it was, say, 15, 20, 30 years ago when some of us started this work. And their definition of place is different.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I mean, their definition of place is the community they create on the palm of their hand. Whereas in my neighborhood when I grew up, if I went to the local grocery store and acted up, my mother heard about it before I got home. Why is that? Because she knew the people who were working in the grocery store. Now you order online, you never have to see the people who are in your own community. You don't have to know your neighbors. And unless people are rooted in the sense of place that's physical and geographic, it's much harder to get them to feel this sense of responsibility or even commitment to their community, because their community is virtual. And so part of what we try to do at the foundation is to get back to that grassroots organizing where you do define place by where you live and where you work, and that there is benefit to being together in physical space, just as we are today. To those of you who are watching online, I'm sure it's a great experience. I promise you it feels different in this room.
Mm.
And I worry that this younger generation is losing that texture, and many of them who came of age during COVID didn't develop kind of the social infrastructure skills that you need to, like, develop a sense of empathy And part of what makes these communities weave together is a sense of mutual accountability and responsibility and love and caring and kindness. And that gets lost in the ether.
It does.
And so figuring out as we rebuild communities how to make it relevant to young people so that they too will put down some roots and not simply live virtually.
Yeah. So this is my 17th year here on Mackinac.
I'm jealous.
No, you really shouldn't be.
Right.
And you know, we have a lot of these conversations multiple times. I feel like I've been here before.
On this panel.
On this panel. With Anika. But one of the things that's always kind of dispirited me a little about this is that we talk about these things in the frame of problems and challenges, and we don't talk about them enough in the frame of opportunities or hope. So I want to give each of you just a little bit of time to talk about something that you see that gives you hope about what we're doing in Detroit and Framing Place, or an opportunity that you think we could jump on that maybe we're not.
You know, because I have a new report that was released yesterday assessing the quality of life of Black majority Black places, Black majority places. We released it. Brookings Institution released it yesterday. And the point of this exercise was to compare Black places to Black places against the state to find the majority Black places that are exceeding state averages. The reason why we are doing this is twofold. One, if you always focus on disparity, you'll never get to investment. No one invests in problems. No one invests in problems. You invest in strength. The other piece of this, we have to find the things that are working. When you, not to get too methodological, but when you look at things in the aggregate, knowing the wealth divides and the history, if you only look at the Black-white disparities in the aggregate, it masks all the other positive things that are happening at the local level. This is why place matters, because you can actually detect the growth at a neighborhood level. Even at a city level, there are positive things that are happening in Grand Rapids. There are positive things that are happening in some of the suburbs of Detroit, in Black majority places. There are positive things that are happening in Kalamazoo, but we don't focus on that. And trust me, I come to Detroit a little too much, but every time I come here, there's such a focus on what's wrong. And all I see is this talent. I'm like, no, you got to start, you know. And I'm not, and I say this all the time, I am not the economic development person that is like, we're doing everything right. Mm-hmm. Everything is great. No. But if you don't reward and acknowledge the people who are actually making the city better, you're never going to get the investment to scale and to codify. So for me, we have got to acknowledge there are assets, there are strength in these communities that we need to reward and resource.
Wendy?
Yeah, I think similarly, we look at the assets in communities in our work at the foundation and, you know, invest significantly. And, you know, one of the things I'm extremely hopeful for right now in the city is the conversation around education. Mm-hmm. You know, our work at the Mary Grove campus, which is, for those of you that don't know, is about investing in Detroit's first P-20 educational model in the city. So what would it look like to have a neighborhood school system, again, that is focused on prenatal all the way to and through college? Is resulting in a significant set of conversations about, you know, how do we think about education more holistically, not just on this campus, but across the city, and how we do that in a partnership model. You know, we've kind of come at education where it's the school system's job alone, and we know that that is not the case. It really does take the school system working hand in hand with the early childhood system and the higher education system, and coming at education much more holistically and focused on the whole child and family. And that is starting to happen in our city. And so I'm very encouraged and hopeful about the conversation ahead around education. And even here on the island, the work that's being done to, you know, have, I think, a very candid conversation about investment in education. You know, that is starting to continue to take hold as well.
Valerie?
Well, I'm not from Detroit. I did go to Michigan for law school. Go Blue.
Go Blue. Go Blue.
But when I was in law school, it would really never occur to us to go to Detroit for anything. Once, when the Rent Center opened, we went down there to take a look at it. But that was about it. But I want to say to you who are from this area that your reputation outside of Detroit is really good right now. People say Detroit is the poster child for the city that's coming back. And that's what people are saying about you. And so I think it's good for you to start thinking about yourselves in that same vein and do accentuate the positive. And I think part of what we try to train our young leaders to recognize is, what are the assets? Yes, there are problems, but what are the assets? And sell the assets. And be mindful, don't be Pollyanna about it, but look at the assets and try to help generate this next generation of leaders who are empathetic, who are resilient, who do understand that it doesn't happen overnight the way they get information in the palm of their hand overnight. Change doesn't happen overnight. We were a lot about change and hope, so you're right in my sweet spot here. But the more you feel enthusiastic and passionate about your place, and the best ambassadors are the people who live there. But I just say to you right now, if you talk to people around the country, though, and part of it is you've got a business leader in Jamie Dimon who chose to invest a whole lot of money in Detroit. Mm-hmm. And he talks about it all the time. Why? Because he wants his investment to be a success. Mm-hmm. And he recognizes that he has to talk it up in order for other people to come in and invest. Mm-hmm. And so my hope for you who are from the area, the region, is to recognize what a jewel you have.
Yeah.
With potential.
I would piggyback on that. Also, the importance of us telling our story, telling our own story. And this is not a panel about media, but we have a challenge with that too right now, making sure that we can tell Detroit's story locally and nationally. And we are the best people to tell that story. Go ahead, Anika.
Well, I just, you know, in this, not to bring everybody down, but.
I just told you.
I hope
know,
it's for you.
Hope it's for
you. I don't know what you expect from me.
To say something positive.
This might be your last year on this
podcast. Maybe. One of the things that actually gives me hope is it's actually a problem. But it's a problem that is happening in so many different communities. There is such an opportunity to bring us all together around it that it could be a galvanizing moment. So this idea of Tangled Title or Heirs Property, and it's one of my favorite things to talk about, quite honestly, because it affects people at all levels of income. And in Detroit, the average home that falls into that tangle, and basically what it is that your grandmother has a home, she left it to your mother, according to your mother, but not actually, there's nothing on record, right? Like there's no deed of that. And your cousin is now living in that home and decides to try to sell the home. Mm. And turns out somebody actually bought the home at auction because they don't own it. That problem happens in Detroit. It's happening to 5,500 homes. It's worth about $300 million worth of real estate. But what we also learned is that this same issue is happening in rural communities across the state. And it's happening in Native tribal land. Mm-hmm. So this one issue that is solvable, we can invest in, can also bring us all together as an entire state, how do we protect our assets? How do we protect our wealth? How do we create generational wealth in very, very different kinds of communities and grow us all together? See, I did it.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's right. I was a little worried, but you came through. All right, I want to thank our panel, Wendy, Dr. Perry, Anika, and of course, Valerie Jarrett. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
This is good. Good to see you. It was a good conversation.
This was a lot of fun.
Thank you.